to me to stand before the children of God, and I want to thank Pastor John for this great privilege that the Lord has given.
Thank you, sir.
When we listen to the words of God, faith comes by hearing and hearing the words of God. And I pray that the faith of everyone here today shall be enhanced in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The title for today's message says what? Can we say it together?
The man with many keys.
The man with what?
Many keys.
Many keys. And we know what key is all about, is it not?
Yes.
Pastor.
Yes, sir.
I want to ask you, why is it that you can differentiate a particular key here that opens your car? Why?
Because I know my car.
Because you know what?
I know my car.
And you can know, you can also do what here?
Yes.
Even when, if you close your eyes sometimes, you can touch.
That's right.
Hello?
Yeah.
You can touch and, oh yeah, this is the one that opened the door.
That's right.
And somebody here has the keys. Not even one key.
Many
keys. And today, we shall be considering the life of this man. Let's bow down as we pray. Father, you are the words of life. You are the words that came from heaven, and you dwell among the sinners like us. Today we want to do the exposition concerning your life. And we pray that you give us the insight to hear and to put all these things that we shall be hearing into practice.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you,
in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Let's pick our Bibles. I'm a theologian, so you should expect to read the Bible today. I want you to pick your Bible. We shall be digging down into the scripture today. And what we are going to do today is an exposition. I call it the exegesis of Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. So if you are here, if you are with your Bible, let me see your Bible, huh? Where's the Bible? I want you to hold your Bible. Because we are going to do this together today. Can I see your Bible at the back there? Your Bible? Oh, the phone is turning to the Bible. Amen!
Amen!
My laptop is also turning to the Bible. So, there is a civilization already.
Yes.
But we shall be considering the life of somebody here today who has no telephone, who has no internet, nothing. But he was still able to reach out to the people. The book of Revelation chapter 1 verse 18. Don't forget we shall do the exposition of this verse. And it says, I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to say amen to that.
Amen.
And have the keys of hell and of death. Now let's take it one after the other. We want to bring out the key words, the important words from this text. The first one here is what? Let's say it together. Can somebody tell us what's the first word that is very important in this text? Can somebody try to tell us?
I am.
Oh, praise be to the name of the Lord. Oh my God, you got it right. I am. The book of Exodus chapter 3 verse 14. Exodus chapter 3 verse 14, God said to Moses. You know, Moses was told, go and liberate the people of Israelites. Go and bring them from the captivity. But what did he do? He complained. He said, I cannot speak. Well, I don't know how to say it. What am I going to do? I don't know it. But when he was complaining, what happened? God told him, this is what you should tell them. Exodus chapter 3 verse 14. And God said to Moses, I am who? What?
I am.
I want you to take note of this very important text. It says, I am. Who? I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel. Can we say, can we read it together? I am as sent me to you. How many times do you see I am here? Hello? Student of the Bible, let's look into your Bible. Can somebody tell me how many times you see I am here? I'm looking at my home Bible. 1, 2, 3. 3 times in one verse, I am. Now, when you look at this, compared to Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, what does it say? I am. He. Oh my God. Amen.
Amen.
And one of the mysteries in the Bible is all about the deity of Jesus. The Trinity. You can misunderstand, you know, but this is my own principle. I believe that we don't have three gods. According to this text. Hello? Hello? We don't have three gods. Jesus Christ will be digging down into what he himself called himself. Here, I believe that Jesus was the one speaking here.
Yes.
He said, I am who I am. And he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am as saints mean to you. Mm. And when Moses went to deliver this message and he said, I am, I believe that the Israelites might have known who is
I am.
I am. And Jesus Christ came here, the man we're talking about, the man with many gifts. He came here. I mean, there are many I ams in the Bible. But I just want to emphasize on some of those important ones. John chapter 6 verse 51 says, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever.
Amen.
I am. Who is the one talking here? Who is the one talking here? The man with many heels. John chapter 8 verse 12, then Jesus spoke to them again. Said, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life.
Amen.
And maybe let's use this one. John chapter 10 verse 11. John chapter 10 verse 11 says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. And today, I don't know who can give his or her life. Mrs. Mwanko, can you give your life to your, can you give your life in place of my friend pastor? Can you do that?
When the time comes.
When the time comes. I was in a particular burial ceremony back at home, and pastor, one of the pastors, Pastor Alabi is his name, he was the one conducting the burial. And, you know, the wife was crying, let me die, let me die, let me die. They were holding this woman was saying, no, you don't die with the husband. Pastor Alabi said, let's stop the service. But they bring her here. So, you know, who is in the grave? He said, my husband. Is the husband? You want to die? Jump. The woman was looking, the woman could not jump. The woman was remembering, I still have children. Mm-hmm. Think I still have business, I can still do some. The woman didn't die, he didn't jump and die with the man. But somebody here said, what does he say here? This man here? Huh? Even for one sheep, for one soul. The man with many keys was once in this world with us. He lived here with us. He did some of those things we are doing today. He wore clothes. And sometimes I don't even think you wore this type of clothes. No. Some people misunderstood or misunderstand that, because they say, if you know, there is a thing that says man should not wear, a woman should not wear what belongs to a woman, is in the Bible. And they said only the time of Jesus Christ they wore, even they wore clothes like the Scottish. You know the Scottish, they wore clothes like women, like, oh, Jesus Christ might have wore clothes that looks like that of a woman.
That's right.
I don't want to go into that today. But this man also worked. He was hungry, just like you. This man might have gone to the river to fish, and he caught some fish. He's a man like us. He's the firstborn among the dead. And he slept like us too. In fact, he was at the sheep and he slept very, very peacefully. He slept peacefully. What is the man? He slept. He was hungry. He was tempted. Right from the beginning of his ministry, he was tempted. When he went for the marriage ceremony and the mother was saying, this is the time. Yes, you have to, you know, I'll get back to you. You are my son, you know. Perform the miracle here. They said, my time has gone. It's not your time. And the man with many kids had friends. He had friends. And unfortunately, people didn't expect him to be friends with people that he was friends to. It's good to be good. It's good to be good. It's good to be nice. Last week I met somebody and I was just driving and I parked my car, and at the park I sat down and I was just there and I was looking at a lady who was crying. What is going on? What is happening to this lady? And something told me to go to and talk to her, and I went to her. And she told me, she said, as you see me, I don't know where to go. I don't know my father. My mother is addicted to drugs. My sister is mentally, she has series of mental illness, you know. She has gone through stages of depressions. I was moved in my spirit. I didn't know what to do. And I said, okay, I don't know if it is right, if it is true or not. He said that she's not, okay, where are you staying? He said he was staying with somebody, but that person said he should go away. He said, can you take me to that person? And we went. I went with her. Yes, I went with her. She gave me the number, I called the person, and we went to that person, and you will not believe. God is alive.
Amen.
God used me to speak to this man, the owner of that house. And this man said, the reason why, you know, bills, somebody, but he said, I like the way the pastor's wife mentioned, bills, forget the bills. And I said, that thing strike my mind. Because I have bills. Madam, you have bills? You have bills? I have many bills. I remember, I said, bills. That is a big message for me today. Bills, forget your bills. The man said, "Can I try to accommodate this woman? There is nothing I can do. The bills is too much. Electricity, blah 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 blah. She mentioned many things." And I said, "Can you try? Just try. Just give opportunity. Just 1 month. Just a month." The man said, okay. I said, who are you? I said, I am a pastor. He said, he knows the Loma Linda University. So he said, oh, I know your church. So he said, okay, 1 month, okay. And I encouraged this lady, I said, apply to my work. Immediately, try. Second day, go there and apply. And God is good.
Amen.
She went there and she was employed that very day.
Amen.
They asked her to start. Well, you know, if possible, can you go? You know what? You know how you used to do?
Yes.
Can you go to Los Angeles to work? Immediately, they employ her. Without, they've not even done the investigation of her background. They've already employed.
Wow.
And she has a work.
Praise the Lord.
And I'm like a king.
Praise the Lord.
I said, you want to, the hair was just like criminals. I said, you want to change your hair? Call my wife. I said, you know anybody who plays here? She said, yeah, I know. Okay. Go so so way. Go and play your hair. She said, no, I like African hair. Do African hair.
I like that.
Praise the Lord.
God is good.
All the time. Wow.
Though we may not lay our life for somebody, heal ourselves, some we may not, but we can, there is something we can do to help somebody.
Yes.
And this man with many gifts came to this world, he did all to save lives.
Yes.
And when he was in this world, there is nothing like, amen. He was friends to the publicans. In fact, those people were the best friend he had. And when he was entering the house of the publican, what were the people saying about him? They said, oh, look at him. He was friends with sinners. The man with many keys was friends even with the prostitutes. And there was a time I was, you know, there are times when you hear some things, you raise your ear. It's not how you hear that some people, they will hear something about somebody, they already believe. When you hear something about somebody, you already believe. There was a time I saw one particular movie, and it was a movie concerning Mary Magdalene and Jesus Christ. I don't know if you have seen something like that, that Jesus Christ had a boyfriend. Yes. But have you? Huh? Yes. Pastor, I don't know. Have you heard that? Yes. I've seen that. Try to investigate that. Try to do some findings concerning what I just said. Yeah. Yeah. They said Mary Magdalene was his boyfriend when he was in this world. What an abomination. What an... Oh my God. But this man we are talking about does not care. Whatever. Say whatever you like about his life. He doesn't care. Because his heart is fixed. He knows his mission. He knows what he's doing. People misinterpret his way of doing things. But this man with many keys never missed it. He was maintaining that road. And when he forgives sins, people said, who are you to say your sins is forgiven? Are you? And you remember, I said, before your father Abraham, before your father Abraham was, I am. And there was no internet during the time of Jesus. No telephone, no microphone. But Jesus could still stand and preach to thousands of souls, and many souls were converted. You see, we can go many ways to describe I am. Another key word here is that I am he that liveth, was dead. Was he really dead? Did he?
He died.
And you remember when he was talking to these Pharisees, and he said, destroy this temple. He didn't point to himself anyway. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I'm going to do what? What were the people thinking? They were looking at the heavenly temple. You see, there are times when people look at the temple and they say that this is the place where you will be saved. Temple, church cannot save you. Hello? It is not where you are, in a place where it's filled up to the brim, that you are saved. No. It is not the giving that saves. It is the man with many keys that saves.
Amen.
Destroy this temple in 3 days, and people were saying, "You want to destroy the temple that our forefather Solomon?" They struggled. They went to Lebanon to carry the cedar tree to build for many years. They struggled. You want to destroy it? Oh. And he was talking about what? His body. When Lazarus was there, what did he tell the people? He said, "Our friend Lazarus is what? He's sleeping." And they thought that when somebody, one of them said, if he is sleeping, he's going to what? He's going to wake. But Jesus Christ was talking about what? Death. When Jesus Christ died, remember that the Pharisees, they were thinking of how to make him to die forever and ever. And they said, okay, let us send some soldiers to go and, you know, block that tomb so that he won't be able to come out. But your Savior, my Savior, came out. Amen. On the third day. Amen.
Amen.
The man with many keys. He was once dead, but he's alive. And because he's alive, we are alive. Because he lives, you live in today.
Amen.
Say, behold, and behold. Behold is very common in the Bible. Remember the John the Baptist. What did he say? Say, behold. It's a name given to this man we're talking about. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Behold. When he saw Jesus, he said, behold. And he has the keys. Hell here is not hellfire. In fact, he has the key of hellfire too, because he can turn it up, you know, he can change it so that you won't be in the hellfire too. But here, according to this text, the Greek word here is not hellfire. It is Hades. Or Hades. Hades is grief. Grief. Sheol is hellfire. So, we're talking about the grief. Somebody who has the power over what? The grief. Somebody who is able to command the dead and let them rise. And the dead, what? Rise again. And in the life of Lazarus, 4 days. 4 days. It's already done. And for you to know that this man is a man like us. He went. When Lazarus was, when he was confounded, he went. But when he got there, he went there with confidence, because he knows that he has the power over them. And they said, Lazarus, he command, come on! And Lazarus came up. And that is an assurance for you that if we die here, we are going to what? We will be resurrected. If Jesus could be resurrected, we shall be resurrected. I've lost many loved ones too. I've lost many friends who died so just suddenly. It may be somebody who is very a significant person in your family who just died, and you begin to wonder, why should God allow this? But today, that is a message for you. Because the man with many keys has the key to open the grave, and the dead in Christ, we want, we rise.
Amen.
He was once dead, and he was alive. And he's alive forever. And when we talk about keys, we talk about keys that open things that have been shut, that have been closed. And there are times, there is another aspect of it, that when it's shut, no one can open it. I was 2 years ago. I had a transit and at Dubai. And when I got to the hotel, they lost me. You know, when you miss it, you miss your flight. They take you to the hotel, and that hotel, I was there. And the guy who came, I was expecting a key. Pastor, give me that key. I was expecting keys like this. But unfortunately, what I saw was like the ATM. You know the ATM?
That's right.
What? Oh, sorry. I have to tell you the truth. That was the first time I saw that. I was expecting keys. Yes. But unfortunately, I was given a... like, you know, I said, am I going to use this one to eat for what? The man said, this is your key. I said, and when he was trying to give me, I saw many of them in his where he kept them. I said, wow. And he said, you know, say something that really touches my spirit. He said, he brought out one out. He said, in this hotel, said there are about 2,000 rooms, and only this one opens all the doors in this hotel. I said, "Ooh, wow!" And he said, "There is somebody who has the power. In fact, it is when you want to." That as it is now in his hand, he cannot use it because it has been neutralized, you know. It's only the managing director who has the authority to open it. I said, I have somebody who is the managing, is more than the... Amen. Amen. I said, I have somebody who has the master's key. And that is Jesus. He can open doors that have been closed. There are times, I don't think that doors can never be closed. That doors that have been closed. I was talking to one of us, not here, but one of the believers. I said, do you believe there are enemies? He said, no. That is it. This is the time for Adventists to believe that enemies are real. Real? I said, do you believe there are enemies? He said, he doesn't believe. He said, once I have Jesus, I don't have any. I said, see that here. They will deal with you, and you will remember that Pastor Ella said there are enemies. In fact, your neighbor can talk to be your enemy.
That's right.
Huh?
Yes.
Hello?
Hi.
Your brother, your whole blood brother can talk to be your enemy.
Yes.
Your wife can talk to be your brother, your husband can talk to be your children can turn to be your enemy. And I told you, I said, there are enemies. They are real. And if you don't take it seriously, they might have dealt with you before you realize that you have an enemy. Jesus Christ had many enemies.
Right.
In fact, when he was in this world, people who were very close to him, they were the closest enemy that he had. People that they were opening the Bible to them. They were singing in the temple. They were doing everything together, but these people were the greatest enemy of Jesus Christ. But we have somebody who is able to destroy enemies in our lives.
Amen.
And we don't pray that enemies should die, but if the enemy is going to destroy you before you realize it, let that enemy, let God deal with that enemy. You know, there are times that God can be merciful and wait and wait upon waiting for the enemy to repent. But if he does not repent, what happened? Huh? Remember, if your brother offends you,
yes.
It's a text in the Bible. Say, so you take one of your brother to him. If he doesn't, take one of the other and from the church, go, and all of the others. But he didn't listen, what? They handle him like what? Like one of the Gentiles. Give it to the devil. This man we are talking about, the man with many keys, had many enemies at the cross. The enemies, he followed him to the cross. From the beginning of his ministry, when he started 3.5 years, just 3.5 years of his ministry, they started from the beginning. For what? The beginning. For the end. When he was at the, when he was in the wilderness, the temptation came upon him, and he was hungry. Truly, he was hungry. And one of the things, one of the strategies of the devil is that he can use any means. He can use any means. He can use what you don't even expect to become your enemy, to fight you. But the man we're talking about here fought this enemy with the strength of God, and he was overcome. Amen. You shall be an overcomer.
Amen.
I said you shall be an overcomer.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Because of our time, I'm going to begin to round up this sermon, because there's a lot to be said. But just a little word is enough for the wise. The man we're talking about here is going to come back again.
Amen.
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 Did you hear that?
Amen.
I said he's going to come back again.
Amen.
When he comes. Remember when he was entering into Jerusalem, they call it triumphant
entry.
Oh my God. Amen.
Amen.
Before I didn't read in the Bible where Jesus Christ ride on the donkey. Donkey was Jeep.
Yeah.
Donkey was pastor's, you know what I'm talking about? But donkey was pastor, and Elias said, "Is that small to you that you know?" No, nothing like Jeep, nothing like Ferrari.
Yeah.
Nothing like that. During that time, donkey was the major thing. No, they decorated it up. I mean it. Jesus Christ was the one who said, "Go and bring it." You see? He said, "Go and bring one for me." He has never requested for anything like that. But go and bring it. And they decorated the big palm tree, everything, for him to enter.
Like a king.
That is a symbol. It is symbolism of the glory of God in him when he comes again.
Amen.
That is going to come. The man that said, "Can anything good come out from Nazareth?" When one of the disciples was invited to come and join, he said, "Can any good thing come out from that?" No, nothing good can come out from that. No, he traveled to US. Can he do that? Can anything? No, he can never travel. He can never, no way. I don't think it's not possible. But something good can come out from your Nazareth.
Yes, praise the Lord.
So today I'm hugging you, I'm inviting you, especially. Because if you don't know this man, and it is not something like you just say by your mouth, it is within you and your God. It is your relationship between you and God. And that is why the kingdom of God it will be a surprise place for people. Because people will say, "We heard about this man. He's a notorious, he's a sinner. She's a prostitute. He's a womanizer. But surprisingly, you see him in the kingdom of God, you'll be wondering. I pray that you'll be there so that you wonder too. Amen. I said, I pray that you'll be there so that you wonder and say, how did he make it? We made it. I remember your life during that time. You didn't attend church regularly. I remember that time. You begin to talk about it. But all those things shall be things of the past. Because the joy, the everlasting joy of Jesus has been given unto us. I pray that you shall be there.
Amen.
I pray that you shall be there.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ. So at this time, I want to invite you. Is anyone here who wants to accept Jesus Christ, this man, the man with many gifts? Maybe you want to accept him afresh into your life. You can stand up as we pray. Our Father, we thank you. Thank you, Father, because you have the keys. You have the keys that opens what has been shut, what has been closed, you can open. Thank you, Father, because your life is a testimony to every one of us. Father, for all you have done just because you love us. Thank you, Father, for what you are doing right now because of your love. Let that name be praised, Lord. Are there people presently here today that have not known this man? They have not had a personal relationship with this man with many years. I pray that you touch lives here today. I pray that you change life here today. So that when you shall come, we shall be among the people that will be singing hallelujah. We have been expecting you. Let this be our song. That day when you shall come again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Ah.